Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure I welcome all of you to the plenary session on law at the 16th International Research Conference of General Sir John Kothalavala Defence University. This year's conference is held under the theme of Achieving Resilience Through Digitalization, Sustainability and Sectoral Transformation. The plenary session on law is conducted under the theme Law as a Facilitator, Growth, Equity and Governance.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is expected that this session will provide the platform to a wide range of discussions on the diverse fields of law and their operation.
The session is chaired by His Lordship Jayantha Jayasuriya, President's Counsel, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka. The esteemed panel of speakers for this session includes Honorable Dr. Susil Premajayantha, Minister of Education.
Honorable Mohamad Ali Sabry, President's Counsel, the Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Honorable Nimal Siripala de Silva, Minister of Ports, Shipping and Aviation.
Honorable Dr. Wijeyadasa Rajapakshe, Minister of Justice.
President's Counsel Palitha Kumarasinghe, Chairman, Standing Committee on Legal Studies, University Grants Commission.
Mr. Kaushalya Navaratna, the President of the Bar Association.
We would also like to recognize our distinguished invitees, President's Counsel Sanjay Rajaratnam, the Attorney General.
Justice Bhuvanakala Vihare, President's Counsel, the Judge of the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka.
Justice Yasantha Kodagoda, President's Counsel, Judge of the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka.
President's Counsel, Mrs. Indika De Silva, the Solicitor General.
President's Counsel, Rohan Sahabandhu, Chairman of the Legal Aid Commission of Sri Lanka.
President's Counsel, Ms. Priyani Vijayasekara, Senior Presidential Advisor on Legal Affairs, Presidential Secretariat.
Dr. Atula Patinayaka, Principal, Sri Lanka Law College.
Dear Madams and Sirs, we are extremely honored by your presence here at this session today.
Ladies and gentlemen, we now take this moment to invite the Honorable Chair and the speakers of this session up on stage.
Now, I would like to respectfully invite the Rapporteur of the plenary session in law, the Dean, Faculty of Law of General Sir John Kothalavala Defence University, to introduce the Honorable Chair of this session.
Lordship Jayantha, the President's Counsel, eminent panelists, distinguished invitees, members of the Vice Chancellor, Rear Admiral Lanka Kumar, members of the staff, students, ladies and gentlemen. Let me welcome you all again to the plenary session in law of the 16th International Research Conference of General Sir John Kothalavala Defence University. This is the fifth time that His Lordship is chairing this session. Firstly, he came in 2016 as then Attorney General, and in the last 3 years consecutively, His Lordship was gracious enough to accept my invitation and to preside over this session. Before I briefly introduce His Lordship, I would like to clarify a matter That is, you might see a number of ministers of the cabinet are on the panel. This is not a political platform, but an academic platform. They were invited for a reason. One is that the executive arm of the government is given a chance, a platform, to disseminate, express the executive policy on various matters. Secondly, they have all been lawyers, legal professionals, could inspire you, the future lawyers of this country, to attain high public office. Lawyers always rule the roost. Everywhere, the leaders of the countries are mostly lawyers. I have told to that in many lectures. In fact, I plan to invite the president also, since he is also a legal professional. But then I had second thoughts that if he is to be invited, then our new vice chancellor would have had a sleepless night yesterday thinking about his security. Therefore, I refrain from inviting the president. To begin the introduction of the about his lordship, he received his education at Malidev College in Kurunagala, where I also had my primary education some time ago. Thereafter, he entered the Sri Lanka Law College and was admitted to the bar in 1982. He obtained an MPhil from the University of Hong Kong on a Commonwealth Scholarship in 1992. Then he joined the Attorney General's Department in 1983 as a State Counsel and was promoted steadily and ended up becoming the Attorney General of the country in 2016. Meanwhile, he was sworn in as a President's Counsel in 2012, and he is also a solicitor in England and Wales. During his long career at the Attorney General's Department, he functioned as the head of the Criminal Division and assisted the Presidential Commission of Inquiry in relation to the activities of non-governmental organizations and the Special Presidential Commission of Inquiry in relation to the malpractices and corruption in state institutions. He also functioned as a legal consultant to the Financial Intelligence Unit of the Central Bank. He worked for the United Nations as a trial attorney in two war crimes tribunals and was awarded the Prosecutor of the Year award in the year 2012 by the International Association of Prosecutors. He was appointed as the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka in April 2019. Now I cordially invite His Lordship to commence the plenary session in law with his remarks. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Thank you for that introduction. And so I have been requested to chair this session, the plenary session on law. And we have gathered today to, under the theme, to consider law as a facilitator. A facilitator in areas which are very relevant to the day-to-day lives of the society. And so in that context, as it was said, we have six eminent speakers, and of course who need no introduction, and as all four individuals have reached very high excellence in their respective areas and fields, and also all six of them are attorneys at law who had been in active practice, four of them, and the other two are continuing to be in active practice in law. And so as the first speaker, we have Dr. Susil Premajayantha, who had been an active legal practitioner, who thereafter took into politics, and currently holding the portfolio of education, one of the most important areas, and where he would address us on the role that the technology that can play in this digital area in education. And so may I invite Dr. Susil Premajayantha to address the gathering.
His Lordship, the Chief Justice of Supreme Court, Honorable Ministers, the other members of the panel, Justice of Supreme Court, President Councils, Academics, Professionals, Dean of the Faculty of Law, KDU, the Vice Chancellor, and other Deans of the Faculties of KDU. Dear students, I am attending for the third time and your 16th International Research Conference 2023 organized by General Sir John Kothalavada, Defense University. The system of education in Sri Lanka is now entering an era of reforms and transformations. I am using both words, reforms and transformations. While reforms are incremental and reversible, the transformations are fundamental and irreversible. While education curricula are being reformed, institutions and processes of education are expected to go through transformations. For an example, the National Colleges of Education, where the teachers, the trained teachers to teach from grade 1 to 11 are trained, will be amalgamated and transformed into a university in education in our country for the first time. The digital transformation in education is taking place, where the processes and products are digitalized to radically change the way teaching and learning would take place. Last year, when I was attending the General Assembly of UNESCO, all member countries, 194 countries, agreed upon to introduce the digitalization in respective countries in education. We are also in the process of introducing the digitalization. 3 weeks ago, I was in Beijing attending the Digitalization of Education Global Conference. The China, so at the moment, they have the largest population in the world, somewhere around 1.4 billion population. So they have digitalized by now the 95% of schools in China. But unfortunately here, we are lagging behind. So the government has decided to expedite, and the reports regarding the policy framework is ready by now. Within next 2 weeks' time, it will be submitted to the cabinet. Now, after the approval from the cabinet, it will be presented in Parliament. So, this is the policy framework. The digitalization of education is a major part of policy framework in our country in education. The digital transformation in education focuses on accessibility. Digital technologies enable learners to access learning resources more easily and less expensively than traditional education. The people across the world, from all ages, with different socio-economic status, have access to classes and resources through the internet. Technologies such as text-to-speech, remove the barriers for students with disabilities. The next, interactive learning, micro-lessons, videos, interactive tests, gamification, etc. are all different learning formats that are transforming education with a more interactive learning environment. The next, customized learning, computer technology and AI, artificial intelligence, enable educational methods such as adaptive learning, where each learner is allowed to learn in a way appropriate to them. So we are about to launch the introduction of AI, the subject IT, we have already introduced from grade 6 to 13, from grade 8. All the syllabuses are being prepared by National Institute of Education with the support of Microsoft, with the international standards to introduce AI from grade 8. So within next couple of years, our students, when they leave the school, they are equipped with IT and AI both. The school shutdowns and weaknesses of distance education are some of the most recognized effects of COVID-19, which have demonstrated the importance and urgency of incorporating digital technologies in education. Even before the pandemic, the education industry was in the process of digital transformation. Let us take a look at the key technologies and trends that are enabling digital transformation in education. Artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence applications can undertake simple but time-consuming tasks in education to ease the workload of educators of school staff. They can also be used to deliver an improved and custom learning experience to students. Analytics. Digital technologies enable schools to collect and analyze a wealth of data about their students to monitor and enhance their performance. Using traditional and advanced analytics, they can determine where students struggle and succeed, develop new methods, and test whether these methods yield expected results. Augmented reality or virtual reality. Augmented reality and virtual reality technologies can create interactive and virtual environments for students and help them better engage with the subject. These technologies can enable virtual field trips to historical locations of facilitate learning by doing for applied sciences and medicine. The distance learning experience can also be improved with these technologies. Internet of Things. The increasing use of smartphones and other edge devices improves the connectivity between students and their education institutions by enabling real-time communication and data transfer. These devices can also be used to track young children's absence or presence in class and alert teachers and parents for their security. We are in the process of introducing database of all 10,135 public schools covering 4.1 students and NEMIS program for teachers where we have all the data, the categories of teachers, their experiences and their deployment. So within next few months we are going to introduce both systems in the education. So, by application of technology. So then, online learning, distance learning through Zoom or Skype was an emergency response from schools and colleges to the pandemic. Education institutions can also build their own online class systems, commonly called learning management systems or LMS, and integrate them into their websites or platforms. This will allow them to customize the online learning experience according to the needs of learners or the subject of the course. Then smart classes. We are talking about smart classrooms. In Yafna, you find one particular school. All 62 classrooms are smart classrooms. That is Yafna Hindu College. In Colombo, you find another school, a national school. All 154 classrooms from grade 1 to 13 are smart. That is DSN Nagavidyale. So these are some examples. We are in the process of getting a grant from our friendly country within next couple of months. And we already plan to digitalize 3,000 schools under that particular project. So all the 180 schools, that means the schools where they have all streams, for GC advanced level, science, maths, commerce, arts and technology. And 1C class schools, that is where they have only commerce and arts streams. All these 3,000 schools will be covered with that particular project. So digital technologies have also improved face-to-face learning. Smart classes equipped with smart boards, computers, internet connections, projectors, etc. unlock the ways of delivering learning resources to students that were impossible with the blackboard and chalks. So, I will pinpoint few things with the introduction of technology and the AI. So we have to match our legal system to that particular area. I can remember when once I was in Japan, I had the opportunity to visit one of the science centers in Tokyo. So I had a discussion with technologists. So what they have done, before the introduction of robotics with AI, they have amended their certain acts and they have introduced new laws before the introduction of AI and robotics. So we have seen in some films, not recently, recently I didn't have time to go to the theater, but when we watch televisions and you find some stories about how with the development of technology and especially with AI, so how by using robots can commit some crimes. So we have to get ready for that. The countries like Japan and China and some of Western countries, they have already introduced the laws affecting that particular area. So in our country also, so we are starting from general education and continuing with higher education, all 17 state universities and other non-state universities over there already introduced. And during COVID-19 pandemic, in all the state universities and your university, so you are online. You didn't miss your lectures. Only the practicals, but later on you manage it. So therefore, if we have to experience another pandemic, of course before that, we have to get ready for that. I can remember, at that time I was not a cabinet minister, but we experienced during COVID-19 pandemic, only 50 to 60% school days for our students in general education. At universities, of course, they manage up to a certain extent with the application of technology. So therefore, we are getting ready for that. Within next 1 year or half an year, we will be able to provide with all the economic setbacks. We can't forget the importance of education. So therefore, government is committed to introduce technology, but cautiously, because we have seen some crimes committed by using smartphones and Facebook. So therefore, as legal professions here, we have all these very experienced presidents' counsels and attorneys. So in front of His Lordship, the Chief Justice and justices of the Supreme Court and Honorable Attorney General. So we all are committed to see with the application of technology, we have to see, we have to safeguard our younger generation and by whole the country. So thank you very much for giving this opportunity. I stick to the topic, Your Excellency.
Now, I would like to respectfully invite the Dean Faculty of Law to present a hard copy of the Law Journal to the Vice Chancellor.
Thank you, sir. We kindly request you to remain on stage. We would like to invite the Chief Justice, His Lordship Jayantha Jayasuriya, President's Counsel, to present the tokens of appreciation to the speakers of the plenary session on law.
We would like to respectfully invite President's Counsel Palitha Kumarasinghe, the Chairman, Standing Committee on Legal Studies, University Grants Commission.
We would now like to invite Mr. Kaushalya Navaratna, President of the Bar Association of Sri Lanka.
Ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to respectfully invite the Vice Chancellor of KDU, Rear Admiral Damika Kumara, to present the token of appreciation to the chair of this session, His Lordship Jayantha Jayasuriya, President's Counsel, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka. Now I would like to respectfully invite the Dean Faculty of Law to present a hard copy of the Law Journal to the Vice Chancellor.
Thank you, sir. We kindly request you to remain on stage. We would like to invite the Chief Justice, His Lordship Jayantha Jayasuriya, President's Counsel, to present the tokens of appreciation to the speakers of the plenary session on law.
We would like to respectfully invite President's Counsel Palitha Kumarasinghe, the Chairman, Standing Committee on Legal Studies, University Grants Commission.
We would now like to invite Mr. Kaushalya Navaratna, President of the Bar Association of Sri Lanka.
Ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to respectfully invite the Vice Chancellor of KDU, Rear Admiral Damika Kumara, to present the token of appreciation to the chair of this session, His Lordship Jayantha Jayasuriya, President's Counsel, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka.